Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship here at Kilrenny this Sunday morning. And no matter who you are, how many times you've been here, how few times you've been here, whether you're here in person or watching us later online, everyone is welcome here in God's house. Now, when I was making the service up at the end of the week there, I think, I've not got much to tell them this week. I've got no intimations. 2 pages later, and a whole scribble of notes from this morning, we've got quite a lot, so sit back, relax, and I'll go through it all. First things first, really important, and I think some real gratitude as well. Christian Aid, thank you to everyone who donated and was involved in the fundraising. Buying quizzes, being part of the Pito drive, all of these good things. You've raised £674.50. And the gift aid that we claimed is another £102.50. So a very satisfying round number of £777. I think that's worthy of a round of applause for that. That's excellent. Well done. This will make a real difference to the lives of people in Malawi. And can I say thank you to Leslie and Jim for supporting, doing the work they have in supporting Christian Aid and keeping this in the forefront of our minds here in Kilrenny. Anne Thompson's looking for items for a jewellery stall that the church will have at the Cairo Festival on the 22nd of July. Anne described it as bits and bobbles, is that right?
Beads
and bobbles. So whatever you've got that's shiny and bright and hopefully might make a few pounds, let Anne know and she'll give you the details of how she's collecting everything. So we'll keep reminding you of that in the weeks ahead. A couple of wider intimations. Fife Law Centre is seeking board members. And they're currently looking to recruit board members with various skills, including financial management, third sector organisations, and their purposes in Fife and statutory bodies, such as local government and health. If anyone's interested, or if you know someone that might be interested, I can pass on the link to the application. So if you know of anyone who might be interested in something of that nature, then please either get in touch directly with them or speak to me and I'll pass on the details. If you're long in Dunfermline at any point in the next few weeks, there's a number of things happening at Dunfermline Abbey you might be interested in, including an art exhibition called the Heart for Art, which is running, I believe, between the 10th and 16th of June. So if you happen to be in Dunfermline, it's worth taking a detour to the Abbey and see what's happening there. I said last week there'd be a bit of an update on the General Assembly, and I'm not going to go through all the ins and outs, you would be delighted to know, but Life and Work have produced a four-page summary of the key debates and actions from this year's Assembly. If you want a copy of the supplement, it's available on the Life and Work website, and I can give you the details to access that if you need it. The East Duke Food Bank, this is a monthly reminder that we try and do, that we collect each week, we collect for the East Duke Food Bank. So there is a box just out in the vestry, in the vestibule. Please, if you've got anything you can contribute to that, then please do so when you're able to. I appreciate these are tough times for everybody, but you know, if we're feeling the pinch, there are others who are really struggling. So if you're able to, then that would be appreciated. As always, we have tea and coffee after the service in the church hall, so please come and join us, share your news, catch up with people you might not have seen for a while. Today is Trinity Sunday. It's the last in a sequence of Sundays celebrating the events of the season of Easter through to Pentecost and the giving of the Holy Spirit. And today we contemplate the nature of God, three in one, Father, Son and Spirit. Next Sunday we enter what's known as ordinary time in the Christian calendar. Now that's not an excuse for sitting back and just going, nothing happens. It's much more a case of us beginning to contemplate how we relate to God. So we've done some of the very high evangelical, high theological events over the last few months. Now it's much more about how we relate directly to God. We'll begin that today in our thinking of Trinity Sunday, but we'll carry that forward in the weeks and months ahead. Let us come and worship the Lord. Father, you send your word to bring us truth, and your spirit to make us holy. Through them we come to know the mystery of your life. Help us to worship you, one God in three persons, by proclaiming and living our faith in you. Amen. Let us begin by singing hymn 111, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. 111.
Upon it and vow to take better care of it.
Loving Lord, we come to you, the one who is God of all creation, the one who brought forth life and light from emptiness and darkness, who formed the restless oceans, the soaring skies, the beautiful and productive land, who populated them with the beauty of the creation we see around us and marvel at each day. The God who created, who completed creation, and who saw that it was good. Loving Lord, we come to you, the one who created us in your image, who gave us responsibility to steward your good creation, who entrusted your handiwork to us to care for and to nurture. But we confess before you that too often we have failed that trust. Too often we have failed to guard the goodness and integrity of the creation which you have entrusted to our care. Too often spoiled what you have given us, preferring instead to pollute, to profit from, to exploit. Too often failed to give thought to those with whom we share this beautiful planet, far less to give glory to the God who made it, and who despairs at the groans of all creation. Holy Lord, accept from us, we pray, our confession of guilt, our plea for mercy, and our turning to you in repentance. Accept from us the sincerity and humility with which we bow before you. Inspire your people, we pray, to work tirelessly to care for the world around us, to be forever mindful of all our fellow inhabitants of this earth, and to do so to your eternal glory and honour. Loving Creator God, we give thanks for all your work, the heavens, the oceans, the dusty deserts, the luscious jungles. You've entrusted us to care for, to nurture, and to support all the wonders of the world. We ask for your guidance as we seek to do better, to be your healing hands and to show your love for us and the world in our actions to protect the environment. Throughout history, we have been too quick to tear down or attempt to remodel your creation, rather than consider how you placed each and everything on this earth for a reason. Every creature is unique. It has a purpose and a place. Amazing God, you placed every single twinkling star in the sky, and you know them each by name. You are all powerful, untamable, and mighty. You are love, gentleness, and compassion. Awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing God. Empower us to make ethical choices in community with one another, as we use our actions to worship the earth's beauty. Because if we try to do this alone, we will fall short. May our actions be mindful of the different privileges, abilities, and resources that we have, always striving to lift up those most affected by the climate crisis, but who have contributed the least to it. As we seek to deliver your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, may we turn our attention to you, Lord, and never cease to give thanks for your works. And now we join our voices together with believers around the world in the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us sing again from the hymn book. Hymn 158, God Moves in a Mysterious Way, hymn 158.
Our first reading this morning is Psalm 8, a Psalm of David. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise. Because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Amen.
You'll notice between the prayers and the opening reading and the hymns that creation and God's work within creation is one aspect of today's service. And Sybil and I was just before the service watching the swallows swooping in and out to the little nest above the door. And it's just amazing to think that they come back year after year from West Africa, wherever it is they go to in our winter. And it is that part of creation that we are so fortunate to have, but we can easily take for granted and forget about. We'll turn our minds now towards the nature of God and begin that with our next hymn 356, Meekness and Majesty, 356.
Oh.
Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 11 to 13. Final greetings. Finally, brothers, goodbye. Aim for perfection. Listen to my appeal. Be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints send their greetings. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the final reading is from Matthew chapter 8, verses 16 to 20. The Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Amen.
Thank you, Leslie. Today's prayer for peace was written by the Reverend Dave Herbert of the United Reformed Church. Let us pray. Eternal God, as we are overshadowed once again by war, we lift up before you the innocents and the vulnerable, the victims of violence and cruelty, along with all who continue to sow the seeds of hate. In the fog of war, where truth is the first victim, may your light, which cannot be overwhelmed, expose the truth. Grant to world leaders and all in positions of power today, not only the wisdom, but also the courage to do what is right in your sight. Grant all who turn to you your strength and fortitude, your inner peace, along with a continuing faith in your sovereign power in the face of military might. All this we pray for in the name of the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, our living Lord and Saviour. Amen. Our next hymn is hymn 154, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder. 154. words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord. Amen. Last Sunday we celebrated Pentecost and spoke of the mystery of God's action within the world. How we can only know so much and must accept there are things we cannot understand. Today we come to one of the most challenging aspects of our faith, Trinity Sunday, day when we try to say something about the nature of God and how God consists of three different natures, Father, Son and Spirit. Last week I spoke about how our modern mind struggled with some of the mysteries of the ancient worldview, of what it was like to believe in the miraculous. However, even those in the ancient world struggled with this concept of having a God with three different aspects, but one nature, three entities, but one existence. Those who were brought up in the Jewish faith couldn't conceive of any way of God that they knew being divided or becoming more than one. Those from Gentile backgrounds where multiple gods were the norm struggled with the idea of one God, but three personalities within it. So, we can be forgiven for struggling with the notion of one God and three persons. One of the problems you'll have already detected from the way I'm speaking about the concept of the Trinity is that we struggle to find the language to try and express these ways of thinking about the very nature of God. The theologian Alistair McGrath tells a story of an encounter between Augustine, one of the great fathers of the Christian Church, and a little boy on a beach. The little boy had dug a small hole in the sand and was going back and forth to the shoreline to fill his hands with seawater and carry it back to the hole. And Augustine asked him what he was doing. The little boy said he was emptying the ocean. Augustine laughed at such a nonsensical idea, but the boy responded by saying, "How could Augustine expect to contain the vast mystery of God in the mere words of a book?" McGrath goes on to say this: "The story illuminates one of the central themes of Christian theology and spirituality alike. There are limits placed upon the human ability to grasp the things of God, which led Augustine to realise, if you can get your mind around it, it cannot be God." In effect, we will always struggle to speak of the mysteries of God because we do not and we cannot develop the language that can truly express what God is and how God can be experienced. Marcus Borg, whose work I relied on so heavily last week, speaks of having had a number of mystical experiences in his life and the inadequacy of language in trying to describe what he'd experienced. How his academic and his logical mind was completely challenged by his connection with God and the world of the mystical. He put it this way: "The experiences were brief. None lasted longer than a minute or so, and some only a few seconds. They may not sound like much as I describe them, but I have since learned that this is one of the classical features of experiences like these. They are difficult to express in words. Even when words can convey what was experienced, they can only inadequately convey how it was experienced and the transformative power of the experience." So our first problem, when we try to articulate what we mean by God being made of three parts, Father, Son and Spirit, is we struggle even to find the language to express these ideas effectively. The second aspect we ought to consider is that this conception of God as three in one developed at a very early stage of Christian thinking. You might have thought it strange, and poor Leslie probably wondered what on earth was going on when she got the readings this morning. that the New Testament views were blessings and greetings. There was nothing deeply philosophical or theological within them, you might think. However, they try and capture this concept of the wholeness of God, particularly the blessing from Matthew's Gospel, which establishes this concept of God and Jesus being one and the same alongside the Holy Spirit. Let's hear it again. Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth have been given to me, so you must go and make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." These words are so familiar that sometimes we take them for granted. We don't think about them. We hear them, we've heard them in baptism so often throughout our lives. But this was no construct of theologians from later times. It comes directly from the Gospels themselves. This was Jesus identifying himself directly with his heavenly Father and with the Spirit that was about to be bestowed on his disciples and many more besides. This is also about God going from being a remote being to one who developed personal relationships with his people. Through the work of the Holy Spirit, those who believed could now connect with God directly and intimately. No longer was God just being experienced in the storm or in the earthquake, something remote, something exterior. We could now have a one-to-one relationship with him through his Son, Jesus Christ, and through the Holy Spirit. It can be easy to over-intellectualize the Christian message, but it is this direct experience of God that truly makes the difference. Those of you who've had those moments, those experiences of connecting with God, will know what God means by the inadequacy of language, the inability to express what happened. These are the mysteries of God, the things that are unexplainable, unknowable, but something that each one of us can still access when our hearts and our minds are open to God. They are not accessed through intellectual or theological study, but through the experience of God in person. The God who threw the stars into space and created everything we've ever known still wants to speak to us directly, individually, through his Son and with the aid of the Spirit. It is remarkable, and I have no words to explain how it happens. This is the one Sunday preachers really dislike. We can't explain the things of God, because God is so much greater than anything we can express. So in so many ways, all of us, you, me, everyone, we just need to be open to God, to allow his Spirit to flow through us, to make that direct connection, to feel his presence within us and through us in ways that cannot be expressed in the world. Amen. And may the God of three and the God of one add his blessing to these words. So let us sing again from the hymn book, hymn 130. Ye servants of God, your master proclaim, 130.
Thank you.
offering our prayers for the world this morning, let's remember all those killed and injured in the railway crash in eastern India just a few days ago. Let's come together and pray. Lord Jesus, we bring our offerings to you for dedication, and as we do so, we bring ourselves to be your eyes and ears, your hands and feet, serving and praising your name in all we do. Bless us and bless our offerings, that we may in turn be a blessing to you. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the three in one, the holy and wonderful Trinity, bound together in one eternity of love. Blessed be God, the Creator of all things. Blessed be the Christ, our Saviour and Friend. Blessed be the Spirit within us, our guide and strength. Blessed be God for all that He is and all He has done. Blessed be the One and the Three. Lord God, we ask your blessing upon all who are baptized in the faith, that they may witness to your presence and love. We pray for preachers and teachers, that they may reveal the mystery of your being with us. Lord, guide the mission and outreach of your people. Holy God, holy and strong one, hear us and help us. Holy God, we give thanks for your whole creation. Guide and bless all who work in research and who seek to discover the mysteries of your world. We remember all scientists and researchers. We pray for all who are at school, college or university as they reach the end of the academic year and look forward to exam results, summer holidays or graduation from their courses. We ask your blessing upon all who provide us with our daily needs. Holy God, be among us, in our homes and in our work. Surround our loved ones and ourselves with your love and protection. We ask your blessing upon all who are recently married and those who have a new child in their family. Bless all who are embarking on new challenges in their lives. Holy God, you are ever ready to help us. We ask your blessing upon all doctors and nurses and those caring for loved ones who are ill. We remember all who are ill or coping with life-limiting conditions. We pray for the poor and hungry of our world. We pray for all who feel that they are without help or hope. We ask your blessing on all who are struggling. And now, Lord, in the silence of our hearts, we bring before you all those we know of in need of your care, your comfort, your compassion, and your love at this time. Holy God, holy and strong one, hear us and help us. Holy God, giver of life and life eternal, we rejoice in your presence and ask your blessing upon our loved ones who are departed from us. May they share with your saints in the fullness of your glorious kingdom. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us close our worship this morning with hymn 110. Glory be to God the Father. 114.
Glory be to God the Father.
You have revealed yourself to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Keep us firm in this faith, that we may praise and bless your holy name. As we leave this place and return into the world, for you are one God, now and forever.